One. Welcome to AM Kevin with your host, Kevin Shorey, coming to you live from the Branson Mill in Branson, Missouri. Today's special guest, Dr. Luke Holter, Scott Killian, special music from Jeff Rogers, and now, here's your host,
Good morning. It's a wonderful Friday, November the 20th. I could do dates. I love that because it means we're live. We are live and up in your face today. But best of all, God is all up in your face. He is a very present help in time of trouble. That means he's up in your face today if you let him. Just surrender. This week we've been talking about surrender. Really, as we surrender our lives to Him, that is the key to every great thing in our life. Just letting God be God in our life. Surrender. Everybody say surrender. Habakkuk tells us, behold the proud, his soul is not upright in him. We know in other Psalms and Proverbs that pride goes before incorrect. That's a pet peeve of mine. Never say that again. It does not say pride goes before the fall. It means the same thing, but it clearly says pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. So don't ever say pride goes before a fall again. Pride goes before destruction. To me, that's even worse than just falling, right? Destruction is serious business. And pride is serious business with God. But Habakkuk tells us in Habakkuk 2:4, the just shall live by faith. You got that one right. Amen. And so it's by faith we move and go forward in Jesus' name. Why don't we start with a song? I don't think I was supposed to start with a song, but I just need a song. Let's do a song before we do birthdays, anniversaries, and welcome, and talk about the world and sports and all the fun things that we do. Next service we're going to have here is Monday. We've started. It's time for your miracle. Every Monday night is Miracle Monday night. And so if you come to the audience, we pray for you. If you can't be here, you're in Idaho. By the way, we have some folks from Idaho here today. Yay, Idaho. Thank you for your potatoes. And so wherever you're at, you can watch, send in your prayer requests live, and we will pray for you that hour. It's at 6 p.m. Central. It's time for your miracle this Monday and every Monday until Jesus comes, or the Kick Me Off TV, whichever one comes first. So we just pray that you will experience the miracle working power of God and understand that He is the God that heals. And by His stripes, you were healed. And so that's on Monday night. And then next week, I'll tell you about all the guests at the end of the program that are going to be here next week. It's a great, great week. We will have programs. We're taping extra programs, so we won't be totally live on Thanksgiving and Thursday and Friday, but it will be a brand new program for you to watch at 10 a.m. It'll be there, so it'll be a brand new program on Thanksgiving. And you can be preparing in the kitchen because it's 10 a.m. Nobody's eating turkey at 10 a.m., are they? Unless you're on the East Coast, it'll be 11 a.m. Yeah, I'd like to be, but I don't think it'll be prepared by then. My mom's good, but she's not that good. So there will be a brand new Thanksgiving program for you then, and we'll announce that, okay, next Tuesday. But, big week next week. Let's start off with music. Jeff, I'm glad you're here. We'll talk to you in a little bit, but I don't want to hear you talk. I want to hear you sing. Come on, give a nice hand to Jeff Rogers all the way from Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Thank you. Thank you. This is a song called Your Love Never Fails by Jesus Culture.
Nothing can separate, even if I run away, your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day, 'cause your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because 'cause I know that you love me. Your love never fails. The wind is strong and the water's deep, but I'm not alone here in these open seas. Your love never fails. Chasm is far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails.
You stay.
You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Things work together for my good.
Yes, God. Yes, Lord.
You make all things work together for my good.
Let that be a praise today.
You make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. Stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Your love never fails.
Yes, thank you, Jeff Rogers. Thank you, thank you. His love never fails, and all things work together for good. Somebody say amen. Well, we got a lot of things to cover today, but today, in just a few minutes, you're going to meet Scott Killian, who I've just recently met, but I just fell in love with this book, How to Oust a King. And before you make a judgment about what it's about, wait till you hear what he's got to say today. Today, matter of fact, on November 20th, Hallmark Cards or somebody has made this absurdity day, and it's so perfect for the way our country is right now. It's really absurd when I think about especially how we let all of our countries, other countries, fight our battles. But anyway, not being political or anything, maybe it's because we can't win any battles until we make God the Lord of our nation. But so it's absurdity day, and I think that was really, really appropriate. Also today in history, Ford quit making an unpopular model of car in 1959. Can anybody name what that is? What was it called? That's right, Pastor Gerald, that's right. And also, it's chocolate peanut butter day, so you get a Butterfinger, all right? And so make sure he gets it. If it's broken up, I'll give him another one. But birthdays today. Any birthdays or anniversaries this week? Anybody celebrate any birthday or anniversary this week? Yes? Yes? Marshall, bring that microphone up to him. Yes, you've been married 31 years?
31 years, a couple days ago.
Well, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary. And we are going to send you, how about dinner for two? Would you like to go? Have you been to Mr. Gilberti's?
Yes, a long time ago.
Would you like to go again?
Yes.
Take your wife for 31 years, and when the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's Gilberti's, that's right. And so We're sending you to Gilberti's, all right? They got a ticket for you. They're coming right now with the ticket for you. You get a free dinner on us. Thank you. And everybody go to Mr. Gilberti's. Everybody go to the Christmas lights. Oh, my. The Branson Gift of Lights, brand new Christmas lights. We got to get real pictures or whatever. But there's pictures right here. That's not really a good picture. That's something that says, you know, there is a light, so I'm not making it up. But you go through, and you'll be through 10, 15 minutes through, but you'll see some of the most, he said, over 200 displays of lights there. He was on the program yesterday, Chris was, that set this up. The chamber wasn't going to do it, and he put up the funds, and he decided to do that. That's the Branson Christmas lights. Go see the Branson Christmas lights. We'll have lights and music and stuff coming up here pretty soon just to show you. Pictures right from the lights. How many have been to it so far, driven through? Isn't it gorgeous? Is it gorgeous? Yes, I heard an amen. And these are folks visiting from out of town. So they put together in less than 30 days, but it looks like they took years to put it together. It's beautiful, beautiful. Do that also in coming up in a few weeks. I'm going to be part of a big celebration. Every month, the first Sunday of every month at the Doug Gabriel Theater, and Doug was on the program yesterday, the Doug Gabriel Theater hosts the Jammin' for Jesus, and we're going to talk about that because I'm one of the guests, hosts of that big event, and they always have so many different singers, and it's just a couple hours full of just fun and a blessing and inspiration, so you don't want to miss that. Also celebrating birthdays today. This was RFK. This was Robert Kennedy, his birthday today. Richard Dawson. How many know Reverend? The original host of Family Feud, and before that on Hogan's Heroes. Dick Smothers from the Smothers Brothers, right? Bo Derek, moving along. Edwin Hubble. I just had a horrible picture in my head. Edwin Hubble of the Hubble, you know, they named telescope after him, astronomer Edwin Hubble. And then Chester Gould. If anybody can name who Chester Gould is, I will give you $5 off for the Branson Christmas lights the next time you go. Mr. Gould came up with a great cartoon the early 1900s, and it was a detective. It was Dick Tracy. Our anniversary brother gets a ticket. Do you have one of those, too? I think that's in your bag. Give him one of those, and here's a Butterfinger for you, too. Oh, beautiful catch, brother. Yeah. And that's $5. If you don't have one, I'll put it right here at the edge. You can take that. That's $5 off. I think there's one in the bag, though. I think so. All right. So let's get moving. This is just an exciting day today. I want to get in. Oh, I got to do one more thing. I promise, because it's our first time. This brother right here, $5 off the Christmas lights. You haven't seen it, so you need to see it. It's going to be great. What we do is during the week, we collect names, and we're doing a drawing every Friday, and we give away a bunch of gifts. How about, remember Clayton, that big C was on the keyboardist? His CD is available. How about our waterproof solar flashlights that we offer every day? They retail $20. Here you get them for $10, but whoever gets drawn today gets a free flashlight. Also, three of my CDs, if you like my music. If you don't play it, it keeps away rodents, and that's good for you, right? My praise and worship, my best of. I put best of so far, Scott, because I'm not dead yet. So, there could be best coming up, the best of so far. And then my newest, called The Valley Walker. That's the newest I did with producer Gary S. Paxton. Also, we had Wayne Smith on his book, Turn Your Heart. This is his testimony, how his daughter came back and this estranged family came back together in the name of the Lord. So I've got books, I've got CDs, I've got a flashlight. This is your gift today for this person. Oh, I've also got a friend loves at all times. This is a pendant, a necklace that you can wear friend loves at all times. And the winner of that today is... Thank you. That was either a drum roll or somebody had a bad egg today. All right. And the winner, what a interesting, she is here so faithfully every day. And today, of all days, I don't see her, but we'll make sure Judy Cable gets all those gifts today. Merry Christmas, Happy Thanksgiving. That's for Judy Cable. And we'll do a drawing again next week. That is amazing. Thank you so much. And give the Lord a hand. An enlightening tale of defeating corrupt leadership and a final wake-up call for America. I like this because we need America to wake up to the reality that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, You know, there may be a time when that the whole nation will be saved, but I don't know. I don't know, but I know in these end times, sin is abounding, but grace does more so abound. But God's people, really, I'm not speaking for you, I'm just trying to set you up, but the answer for God's people, the answer for our nation will never, the total answer will never come from the White House. It has to come from our house and the church house, right? And when it does, when God's people really wake up to this, I can't wait to hear from the second guest that's coming on, because he talked about last night of God's people really, our nation is confused, he said. And it's true, but it's one thing if the nation is confused. It's another thing if the church is confused about our identity and what we're supposed to do. And this is what you cover, and you do it in such a wonderful way. It's all, this couldn't have happened just overnight. But let's introduce him. Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome Scott Killian, first of all? We're so glad that you're here.
Thank you.
Tell
Thank
us
you.
Where you're from and what you do for a living.
Well, I live in South Springfield here in Missouri. I've lived here the last couple of years. Lived in Florida before that, and originally from Michigan, so I've been all over the place, actually.
All right. Aren't you glad you're not in Michigan?
Oh, right? Yeah, especially this winter.
Snows are coming already this weekend. We're going out to preach this weekend. Matter of fact, if you're watching from Ohio, we're going to be in Hamilton, Ohio, Saturday night and Sunday morning in Hamilton, Ohio at the Dream Center. Myself, Bill Mulder, we'll be ministering together, so it's a double whammy, but I'm praying that we don't run into snow, because I don't mind running into snow. It's trying to get home. That's the rest. I don't need that. Oh, God's people don't need that. Snow should only come at Christmas. I've already worn my Hawaiian shirt in protest for that. But anyway, so now you're in Thank you. In South Springfield. And so what do you do? You don't just sit around writing books.
No, I used to be an engineer, actually, back up in Michigan, Detroit area, an administrator for a community college. But then I got laid off. And basically, I was really searching for where does God want me? You know, it wasn't just about making a living. And I've been searching for work ever since. But in the meantime, I've been like substitute teaching to get by, and still searching for God's plan on my life and what he wants me to do. But this has been on my heart for the last several years, actually. Even as an unbeliever, I think God showed me things that we're not doing things right in this country, even as Christians. And that's what he's impressed upon me in writing this book is he wanted me to design something that was simple for everyone to read, unbelievers or believers both, something that's short and it gets to the point. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm trying to do here is convey.
And it's all
just
done
what
in
you
rhyme
were
and poetically. And then there's little, this is what caught my interest. There's pictures. There's cartoon pictures. I'm in right there. You had me at cartoon. And you didn't hire an artist to do that.
Nope, I did it all myself. And it took a long time. Yep, wrote it, illustrated
and
everything.
The whole book rhymes and the whole book just flows through. But it's like a spoonful of right, sugar makes the medicine go down or something like that, right? You know, and so I know if I had to give an aspirin to my kids at one point before they could swallow pills, you need to crush it up in applesauce. And what you've done is you've crushed up a really heavy subject into applesauce, but it still does the trick. It really still carries the punch. And just tell us what they would find in this, because really in ousting a king, what I got from it, it's not necessarily a personality or person. You know, I'm around here not an Obama basher, any kind of a leader basher, as much as leadership and as much as the spirit that controls and tries to really run this nation when God should be the Lord of this nation. Amen. And so tell us about this enlightening tale.
You know, there's many messages in this book, but when you really get down to it, it addresses our own hearts, the Amen. Reader's own heart. This really is a reflection, a mirror, to show people what's really going on inside of our hearts, because that's the reason why we have corruption these days. We haven't really been doing and obeying God like we should. In a nutshell, basically this was about a community of people that elected a king to improve their quality of life. But what they quickly found out is everything they wanted out of this perfect leader ended up being just the opposite. He was corrupt, and he ended up oppressing them, giving them a huge burden with taxes, taking away their freedoms. Sound familiar at all?
Yeah.
But basically, the king is corrupt, and people were complaining about it for years on end, but nobody ever did anything about it.
Come on now.
Finally, a youth arose and just said out of the blue, why don't we do the obvious and resist and unite. But unfortunately, the crowd united against him and rebuked him for what he said, because they said, oh, it could never be done. It's never been done before. We don't have a strong leader. We don't have the money. You know, we're tackling something that just will never change. It's
that
just the way
to me
it is.
That sounds to me like the why churches don't do what they're called to do. They have these excuses. We don't have the time. We don't have the money. And, oh, the worst dinosaur. I used to do a message called the Jurassic Church. And one of the dinosaurs that just kills churches is, we've never done it like that before, you know. And so this is where our nation is really now. I mean, this is a story, but this has truly become a story of our church and even worse, our nation.
Yeah.
And so go ahead, and how does it all come about? And is there a happy ending at the end? You know.
You bet. But you actually nailed it, Kevin, that it addresses the root issue of our selfishness, our fear, and our pride. Those are the reasons why we're not confronting these issues of corruption. And it's not all the excuses. It's those elements in our hearts that need to be dealt with.
Amen.
Well, make a long story short or a short story shorter, they got to get, there was a number in the community that did realize that we need to address our own problems in our heart. And God put it there. And they did eventually unite, though it was a struggle. They ended up ousting the king, and they were free from their oppression much more than they were before. Mm. But that's not the end of the story here. That's really what this whole story is about. Though uniting is critical, we need to unite as Christians, especially in this nation, and take care of corruption. It's not the foremost message. It's not the foundation. Jesus Christ has to be the foundation.
That's right.
For a number of reasons. Number one, we as Christians, we know that we're all going to go to heaven someday or hell. That's a choice we make. This life isn't about politics, everyday life, making money, government. It's really about serving and choosing Jesus Christ. And that's the foremost priority of all. What's the scripture? What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but lose his soul for eternity? So in other words, you could have the perfect life here on earth, but if you're not saved and you're not doing God's will, it's meaningless.
Amen.
There's no purpose. And if that isn't reason enough, I don't know what is, to change our ways, that would be it. But getting back to even saving this country, which is a huge issue, because we can't just ignore these things in the natural and pretend there's no value to those either. But if we're ever going to make wise choices to be able to, number one, discern who's corrupt, who isn't, what's right, what's wrong in the eyes of God, we've got to know Jesus Christ. We have to have the Holy Spirit in us. You can't do it without him. We've tried it. Look at what the world does every day in trying to make decisions with worldly wisdom.
Right.
It just isn't working.
Yeah.
And without Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit in your heart, he can't change your heart, because that's really the foundation that all of our decisions are based upon. How we perceive things, how we react, how we do everything is really driven by our heart, and only he can change that. We can't do it ourselves, even out of discipline, out of knowledge. I've tried it. I know we all here have, and you fail miserably. I mean, just look at the results in this country today. To think that we've got something figured out is a severe understatement.
Right.
So again, you've got to know the Lord for that reason, just to be able to discern what's right and wrong. Secondly, we need God's favor.
Yes,
I mean,
sir.
We can't. This is a huge problem that, quite frankly, if our heart was right, we wouldn't be in this mess to begin with. We've really created this mess on our own. It wasn't something that just happened or was destined to happen, which a lot of people believe. We've created a lot of the messes we're in.
Yeah, I was in a service last night with Dr. Luke Holter, our guest, and he had a great, great, great point. He said a million great points. He's one of my favorite preachers of all time, if you can't tell. I'm excited about the show today, but and you guys, it's just perfect. Because he said, we talk about the judgment of God and God judging our nation, and it's not necessarily that he is judging, because he's a just God, but it's that we have pushed him aside, and he looks back and says, I want to be there for you. I want to bless you, but you've pushed me aside. And we need his favor, and the reason we don't have it, when we don't have it, is because we have pushed him aside and said we could do it ourselves.
Yep.
Like we were saying from the very beginning, this life is about God. And when we kick him out like we have in this country, he's going to let us go on our own, and we will reap what we sow from sin. He warns us, though it takes longer than we expect. We think we get away with these things over a short period of time, but in the long run, it catches up with you. And especially at the end of this life, it's going to catch up with everybody.
Come on now.
Nothing's going to be unseen, hidden anymore from God. And that's the part we need to really get a revelation of, that we've got to address our own sin and repent. You know, the scripture, if my people will turn from their wicked ways and seek my face, I will heal their land.
Yes.
We're not being healed because we're not seeking after his face wholeheartedly, and we're not repenting from our wicked ways. We're playing the world's games, unfortunately.
Right.
And we're going to reap what we sow from it, and that's why God isn't with us in many respects. He's letting us go, though he's waiting there. He's right before us with an open arm.
A very present help.
But we've got to make the choice to choose him. He's not going to force himself on us.
Yeah.
And again, like you said, he wants us to repent. You read the Bible over and over. So many chapters talk about, like, Israel sinning and then coming back to the Lord. Sinning, coming back to the Lord. And the Lord is so gracious with us. I don't know why he doesn't take care of us right now, but
thank God we're in a new covenant.
I mean, to me, I would have done something a long time ago.
Yes.
You know, I'm not as merciful as he is.
I'm glad we're not God. I sure am. That's for sure. But, we have to be, and you end the book, I love that you end with Scripture that backs up everything that you have to say. I love that it's all bound by Scripture. Also, we have to be one nation under God. And the thing is, we can't be one nation under God. We can't be under anything unless we lift it up above us. And so he has to be lifted up. And that will create us to be one nation under God. Before Jeff comes back to sing again, though, and would you come back and tell us? Because I think everybody should have this book. If you don't have this book, not only so that you can read it and understand it and just, you know, do priority of your life of being an answer, part of the answer for this nation, not a part of the problem, but get more than one. Because I think this should be in the hands of everybody. As a matter of fact, if you buy a few... this is an old trick from way back. Hal Lindsey, back in the days when he wrote the book Late Great Planet Earth, this is before our camera people's time, for sure. They don't know who he is. But he used to take his book. It became a bestseller because he would get copies of his book, and he'd put it, like, in the occult section. He'd put it in the witchcraft section. He'd put it in the different, say, of Late Great Planet Earth or prophecy sections or weird how-to section. I mean, just get extra books and just... put it in bookstores. Let people just get it somewhere in front of people so they can see there is an answer. But I wanted to read this. It says, the moral of this story goes far beyond uniting needs or fighting to oust the king. It's an issue of God, your heart, and eternity, not a selfish or a physical thing. The people thought money, things, and a king would ultimately bring them satisfaction. Fulfilling the desires of their heart once again produced suffering and destruction, a completely opposite reaction. The freedoms and true needs of life are not found by doing what you want or what others think at all. God clearly warns that when we follow our own ways or the world's, and I'll let you have this because it rhymes, pride goes before a fall. Right. And so that's where we are, I think, in our nation, that we just don't have time for God. And I think it causes such confusion. Dr. Luke said it last night, we're going to have to talk a little bit about what you said last night, because it's one thing if the world's confused, but when the church is confused about their role in being the salt of the earth and the light of the world, that's when we get in trouble. But I want you, before we go, just pray with people. Maybe there's somebody that really needs to come back to God or really needs him in their life. Maybe they've never made him king. You know, there is a king that wants to rule in your heart, and it's Satan, and he wants to drag you straight to hell. But there's a King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who wants to rule and reign your heart. And if you'll ask him today and let him be everything for you, maybe there's somebody, and I'm feeling this, there's somebody that's going through just such a hard time. The spirit of suicide is trying to attack you. You just feel so depressed. The spirit of heaviness has come upon you. That's what the Bible calls it. And I want you to be delivered today. I want you to know that the King of Kings wants to rule and reign your heart. Oust the king of depression. Oust the king of this world. But invite in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Would you pray with him? Just look over there at Cameron, too, and just lead people closer to God, back to God.
Lord, we thank you so much for bringing us together today. Lord, this is all about you. Please open our eyes, open our hearts, soften our hearts, Lord. Remove the blinders from our eyes that we don't even know we have, to see how wonderful you are, how merciful you are.
Yes, you are, Lord.
To just turn to you. You have open arms. You want to love us and bless us. And and yet we don't come to you. Help us get through this, Lord. We don't have answers. We don't have the strength. We don't have the wisdom, but we have you. Help us see that this life is about you, that we are about you. We are your creation, that you loved. You died for us, Lord. Help us appreciate that. Turn to you and start living like we should. Lord, we just thank you for everything. Help this nation repent from its wicked ways. Help it put you as the top priority, not being busy, getting things done, making a living, retirement, security, et cetera, et cetera. Lord, you're the answer to everything.
Yes, you are.
And when we finally get a revelation of that, we will be at peace and begin to live like we're supposed to. Lord, we just thank you so much for everything. Continue to do a mighty work with Kevin's show and every one of the audience members out here today. You have a purpose. God loves you. You have a purpose. And if you follow him, you'll find it. You'll find him. There's more at stake than we know. But continue to seek him with your whole heart, and you'll glorify him. In Jesus' name, thank you.
Amen, amen. And the studio audience, he has these books available here, but if you'd like to find them, where do they go to? What's your...
My website is oustaking.com, oustaking.com, where you can purchase it through Barnes & Noble online or amazon.com.
Amen. And you need to get this, and you need to get this in the hand of everybody you know. And let's spread the word that the story's not been final written. It's written in the Bible, the Alpha and the Omega. He's written that. But the final story of America is not written right now. Come on. Let's rise up as God's people. Come on, let's worship him. Jeff, give us another great song. Lead us to the throne.
We're going to sing a song called Give Us Clean Hands. I didn't plan this, but I think it's going to tie in really well with what they were talking about. So if you know it, I encourage you to sing along with me.
A generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. So give us clean hands,
yes, God.
And give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. And give us clean hands, and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Amen.
Thank you, Jeff. Amen. Jeff's from Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Bill, what are you doing in Tulsa? He met you at a pizza place, right? Is that where?
Yeah, a restaurant called Upper Crust. I waited on him and started talking to me, and I don't know how, but I somehow made a good first impression, and now I work for him at his coffee shop.
Come on.
Yeah, 2 days a week, and then I go to school 2 days a week, and then on Wednesdays, I volunteer at a church camp I grew up at called New Life Ranch.
Awesome, and you're going to be with us this weekend in Ohio, right?
Yes, sir.
You're coming. All right, that's awesome. Thank you, Jeff. Amen. And come back anytime, of course. If you don't have your Geneva Bible yet, get this in time for Christmas. We'll send it to you free shipping, and for your donation of $40 or more to help us, we will send you this. This is the original, Dr. Luke. This is the before the King James. Yes, it does. See, you're so smart. You know, that's why you have a doctor in front of your name. This is the Geneva Bible. This is the Patriots edition, because inside is also the Articles of Confederation, the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, all the official documents of the United States. And this is great. I want to get you one, Brother Scott, if you don't have one of these, for sure. And you will probably already have one because you knew all about it. My favorite is the Rules of Civility and Obedience was put in here. Everybody in the 1700s and probably early 1800s had to write these down. There's 110 rules. Yes. Like, show not yourself glad at misfortune at another one's. Do not take your clothes off in the presence of others. There you go. That's always good. Yes. Spit not into a fire, nor stoop low before it. Do not put your hands in the flames or set your feet on the fire, especially if there is meat on the fire. I love that. That's all in there in the Geneva Bible. And if you don't have your generator, please, we have the only affordable and portable generator. And this will be your power source when the power gets out. Northeast had that problem. Denver had that problem. My brother was visiting in Denver just a few days ago, and the power went out, and they were crying. We don't have a generator. See? No cry, weep not. I have your answer. It's right here, all right? And you can find out about that. It's right there on the website, and we'd love to send you. That's free shipping as well. It comes with the solar panel, some lights, the connectors for cell phones and smartphones and laptops. So everything you need to keep some power on when the power goes out, it is for you. Or if you like to go camping, and if you go camping in the snow or ice fishing. Oh, ice fishing. This is fun. You been ice fishing? Have you ever?
Hey, I grew up in North Dakota.
Yes.
So I grew up ice fishing.
That's what I thought, yes. And so, everybody, would you welcome Dr. Luke Holter here today?
Hey, everybody.
He has a book about fishing, as a matter of fact, about fishermen. I love the title.
I do, yes. We've got a new book coming out. We did a pre-release.
Yes.
Just kind of for the places that we were going to ministering, but Charisma House is putting out Filthy Fisherman is the name of the book.
Filthy Fisherman.
It comes out March 1st worldwide, and it's about the qualifications of the completely unqualified.
Wow.
So the book's about that Jesus didn't come to call professional Christians. He came to call filthy fishermen to use them to transform the planet.
You said something last night I never thought about in my life. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty old. I've never heard this before. Yeah, thank you. The fishermen or the disciples were called, but they weren't saved.
Yeah, the disciples that followed Jesus were not saved because Christ hadn't died yet.
That's right. They weren't even Christians. Think about that.
Yeah.
And God picked them and chose them. How much more, knowing that we're saved and the Holy Spirit, we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we're supposed to be, how much more can we be used of God?
I'm telling you, it's actually a remarkable story because the disciples, when they were called, they were too old. You know, a rabbi would go around and find a child and say, "Follow me." That's what a rabbi would say to a child. And then he would raise that child as a representative of himself, a carbon copy of that rabbi. And so if you weren't called at an early age in childhood, you just weren't called.
Yeah.
And Jesus goes to these guys that are way beyond the date that they're supposed to be chosen.
Some cussers.
And says, follow me. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Ask Peter.
Peter, yeah.
Peter had a potty mouth.
Yeah.
You know? It just shows you that God doesn't call professionals.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And how about Thomas, Mr.
Oh, yeah.
Doubter? You made another great point last night. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have gone to your service last night because all I'm talking about is the service because it impressed me so much.
Good, yeah.
Straight from the throne. I mean, at this being old now, I know the difference between flesh and spirit.
Yes.
I mean, at least I'm not the perfect analyst, but man, well, I know when the Spirit is moving. And if you say, well, I'm a doubting Thomas, you know, that's not really a good thing, is it?
Well, some Christians hold on to this weird idea that suspicion is a gift of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, right.
And it's not.
It's not.
And so when it comes to the supernatural aspects of God's character, we need to embrace it, not be doubting, not be Christian atheists, but actually believe in what the Bible says.
Mm, come on.
You know, and people say, well, you know, I'm just a doubting Thomas. You know, God has to show it to me. And God's looking at people going, that's not a good thing.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't show up and go, I am so proud of you, Thomas, for doubting that I resurrected. Like, he was not excited about it.
No.
You know, but people think that it's this great thing.
He even said, blessed is he who has not seen and yet believes, you know.
Right.
But to tell us, give us your background. For some, this is the first time. How was the first time that you've seen Dr. Luke Holter, okay? And you see this man with the cool glasses and the tats, and so you know there's a story there.
Yes.
How did you get to this place as really a prophet? And I don't think a prophet should be ashamed any more than somebody says they're a pastor or evangelist.
Right.
So when somebody says a prophet, that doubting Thomas thing goes up with a lot of people.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
In a lot of Christian culture, when people find out that you're a prophet, I grew up with a pastor for a dad who said, you know, in the culture that I grew up in was never admit if you're a prophet. It's okay to admit you're an evangelist. It's okay to admit you're a pastor.
Right.
It's okay to admit you're a teacher, but don't you tell anybody that you're a prophet.
Yes.
And the reality is callings give identity. And so it's okay to know what you are. You just don't misuse it or, you know, like I don't walk around with a business card that says I'm a prophet. You
right.
know, I don't show up at places wearing a cape and a sword and a staff and be like, I'm a prophet. Like, you can be
It'd
normal
be cool if you
and
had
anointed.
A Jedi sword.
Right, I would take a Jedi sword. Okay. I would take a lightsaber.
Yeah.
Actually, this is how nerdy I am. In my office at home,
yes,
I've got a prayer shawl from Israel that rests on one of my bookshelves, you know, and so it looks very spiritual, mm-hmm. okay? And then on top of that, I've got a complete movie replica of Darth Vader's lightsaber that's resting on top of my prayer shawl.
How did I know that when I said lightsaber? I've never been to your office. I didn't know.
Right. That was one of the first words, actually, I got when I was... Okay, so I'll tell a little bit of my story.
Okay, wow.
So my dad was a pastor. I grew up in church. I liked the idea of Jesus and Christian culture, but I didn't really know Jesus.
Right.
I was a fan of his work,
mm-hmm.
but I didn't really know who he was.
Right.
You know, you can be reconciled to an idea, but not a man.
Boy, that's the truth.
And so that's kind of how I grew up was, I had experiences, but I never really got serious. And then when I turned 19, one of my best friends died. My high school sweetheart, this whole situation happened that was just awful. And my heart was broken and I ran from God. I started at the age of 19. And when I say I ran from God, it was not a slow process. Like, I ran fast and hard. I was a drug addict for 7 years. I worked for a drug dealer for 4 of those years. Toured in a punk rock band for 7 years. And worked at a head shop that sells, bongs, crack pipes, things to get high with. And I worked at a tattoo shop, if you can't tell. And so when I was 25... This is how Jesus found me. And
I love this. You don't know how much I love this story.
When Jesus found me, I was having a heart attack from a drug overdose in an emergency room. I was living with a lesbian and dating a stripper witch. And that was my life. That's when Jesus found me and said, I have to have you. You know, man doesn't think that way. But God does. And he saw the value of who I really was created to be.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
And on that emergency room table, you know, I had to get heart surgery and all this crazy mess. And I dedicated my life to Christ at that table. I had an encounter with Jesus. And he gave me an option. He said, you can die, which was a real option because, I mean, I was a drug addict. I was miserable. I had stolen from everybody I loved. And, you know, my life was miserable. And he said, or you can stay. And when he said the word stay, two pictures fell out of his mouth. I know that sounds weird, but they were like Polaroids falling out of his mouth. One was of a short Asian woman in a wedding dress. The other was of a brand new baby girl in a birthing unit. So I knew if I lived, I would have a wife that loved me and I would have a family. And so I said, I want to live. And I gave my life to Christ at the age of 25 on that table. I rededicated my life, what I really consider my real authentic conversion, because I actually started bearing fruit of a Christian life.
Amen.
And 7 years later, I met my wife, who is Filipino.
It's beautiful.
Across a crowded room at church. And
best place to find a mate.
I'm telling you, I was way out of my league.
Yeah, I'm telling you. I understand.
I met my wife, totally. And she was at church, and we were making small talk. I was between careers.
Yes.
and I met my wife, and she was working for NASA developing software.
Okay.
Right. My wife's degrees were in mathematics and computer science. And so I was way out of my league.
Yes.
And I relied on the Lord to trick her into marrying me. And
I know.
Well, we got married, and you know, we're just celebrating 8 years next month. And so 8 years of marriage. Yes.
Great.
And you know, we were told by doctors that we couldn't have children. Fertility clinic. They said I was an F minus in my ability to have children. They told my wife she had extreme polycystic ovaries and she would never carry a child. And we went home and we were depressed, and then we prayed and we decided not to let disappointment determine the truth about who God is. Amen. And so I laid my hands on my wife and I prayed and I said, you know, we're going to have a child. And a month later we got pregnant, and now my daughter's 3.5 years old.
Hallelujah. Yes. Mm-hmm.
We went back to the same fertility clinic and we said, hey, y'all said we couldn't have babies. My wife's pregnant. So they did the exact same test again, and I was rated at an A-plus in my ability to have children.
All right.
And they told my wife she didn't have a single cyst or bump on her ovaries, that she could have as many kids as she wanted.
God is good. So, Come on, give the Lord another hand.
Amen.
The only bummer thing about the live program is it's short of time.
Yes.
And,
I'm long-winded, so.
Yeah, well, no. It's awesome. It's awesome. And maybe we'll keep running for an overtime, I don't know, just an overtime. People want to, I know, if they want to go past the time, they can't. I don't know what we'll do, but we want to keep it on because I think he's got a word for folks. But to encourage people that the prophetic is real, because there are still those doubting Thomases out there, give some of these testimonies.
And
just do what you do, and I'm not stopping. We've got 10 minutes live, and then we can continue to do whatever, because you have such a word, and you may have word for people in here, people watching, just however that you feel to move in the prophetic, because you definitely are a prophet, and you come from a great one of your mentors and one of my favorite prophets of all time, Bobby Connor.
Yes.
He has spoken to our to our family many times, and wow, it's really strong. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I love you as well, because you're connected with him, one of my favorites. So it's minister to our family. Wow. I didn't see that one coming, but I want to stop talking, and I just want to make sure that I'm going to stop talking. So I want to say everything I got to say before I let you go. But first of all, about our nation, I think we're on track today, really. Don't you, as well as God's people, really need to rise up? And the greatest thing that we have is the miraculous, the signs and the wonders, the prophetic, the healings and miracles that no other cult, no other religion has, and yet we just diminish it or say it was for another time. We make all these excuses, and we don't let the Spirit of God run in our churches. Take what I said, run, and then go.
It's true that right now, more than ever, the world around us, as well as the church, needs to see a display of God's power.
Yes.
A display that God is, you know, the Word of God says that He is more supernatural than He is natural. And we need to embrace that. But unfortunately, what's happened in a lot of Christian culture, and even the world's seen it, is charlatans, snake oil salesmen.
True.
People that can go to places and their prophetic words are mostly like cheerful guessing. And into people's lives, and they'll say things like, you shall live and not die, and then that person dies a month later, and you know, they're like, well, I guess the word wasn't true, you know. And so I grew up in a culture too where the prophetic, it was embraced, but really the most prophetic thing we had was you know, this red-haired intercessor in our church that nobody understood. She cried a lot, and she had like 12 Star of David tambourines and a bunch of flags. And like that was kind of like all we knew about the prophetic. And you know, the Lord cashed in her prayers in my life. as I grew up, you know, as I, you know, when I was a kid, I was like, oh, this lady's crazy. Yeah. You know, and then when I was a drug addict, I remember when the Lord encountered me and he said, I'm cashing in the prayers of your family and this intercessor that have prayed for you your whole life, you know. Wow. And so, but I think the church has seen, you know, there's a huge prophetic movement in the 80s and early 90s.
Right.
And unfortunately, that was mishandled because there wasn't a lot of mothers and fathers in the movement. Mm. There was a lot of loose cannons, a lot of latchkey kids that raised themselves. Wow. And thought, you know, we'll just do whatever seems best to what we experience rather than getting educated. And so we've seen some miraculous things with the supernatural, with words of prophecy. I shared some of them last night. You know, what's amazing is it's impossible for an atheist to argue with a prophetic word.
Exactly.
When you know things that there is no way that you could know only by the revelation of the Father, there's no way that you can reason around that. And I'm not just talking about the Lord looking at somebody and saying, hey, you seem neat, or you look like a nice person, amen. Like, I'm talking about knowing things from people's childhood that you just possibly couldn't know. My wife and I were at an event in Canada, and this is one of my favorite testimonies. We were at this conference in Canada, and the Lord said, it was the first night, and I had the first night. And so I was like, all right, Lord, I just really want to increase faith in the room, you know, and get people on the same page. And the Lord says, I want you to prophesy over this woman. He said, she's a children's pastor in the city, not even from this church. And I said, okay. And he goes, but I want you to tell her she's become bitter because she could have no children of her own. Now, that's where I pause, because I'm like, Lord, I don't want to give a negative word, right? Like, you know, see, because the Lord will always give life at the end of a word. You know, right. Satan will exploit your weakness. He'll address only your weakness and never give you life.
Yes. Listen.
That's why I never believe a prophetic word that only brings about your weakness.
Come on now. Listen.
And
to that.
So the Holy Spirit said, and tell her this time next year she'll embrace a son. Hmm. Well, now I'm freaking out because I'm like, Lord, I don't want to. What if she doesn't have a baby? Can we be real? Can we be practical about it? I'm like, what if she doesn't have a kid? She's going to be super bummed out and it's going to be my fault because I need to take ownership of the words that come out of my mouth. And the Lord says, Luke, if you don't speak it, it won't happen. So I prophesy over her and I say, this time next year you'll embrace a son. Give her the whole word. She's crying. 8 months go by and my wife and I get an email. She said, I want you to know that I was so angry at you for prophesying over me, for addressing the fact that I couldn't have children. She said, you made me so angry and I just couldn't hope anymore. And you speak this word at the moment of my greatest pain where I don't want to believe. And she goes, well, I'm emailing you right now to let you know that I'm 8 months pregnant.
Amen.
She said, I'm having a son, and I'm gonna raise him as a prophet. She goes, but what I didn't tell you when you were prophesying over me was that I had had a hysterectomy.
Come on now.
She had That's no uterus Jesus. To even carry a child. And so I asked the Holy Spirit, I said, how did you do that? You know, it's okay to ask the Holy Spirit that. He's not an idea or a vapor. He's a person.
Right.
And you can communicate with him just like we're talking right now.
Yes, sir.
And I said, Holy Spirit, how'd you do that? And he goes, oh, baby boy, that was easy. He said, Psalm 139, if I can knit you together in your mother's womb, I can knit together your mother's womb. He's still a creative God.
Yes, he is.
Amen?
Yes, he is.
And so we've seen miraculous things. Thank you know, we've you. Prophesied over homosexual atheists. Oh, cool. You know, we've prophesied over people that would shock you. That God would speak into their lives. And it's one of those things where people in the church have seen it done in a way that's unhealthy, where you think you have to be spooky or weird
right.
to be anointed. And right. I want to encourage you, you don't have to be eccentric to be powerful. You can be normal and anointed.
Yes.
Amen?
It's for everybody.
For the viewers
isn't it?
At home, you can be normal right. and anointed. Like, you don't have to be weird. You don't have to show up wearing a robe and a staff, looking like Gandalf from Lord of the Rings.
That's right.
Like, you can just be normal and anointed. That's who God cannot anoint the Bill Johnson in you. Mm. He can only anoint you. Mm. And so that's why it's important that you embrace the uniqueness of who you're created to be. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Boy, isn't that the great word? I mean, I don't have it. You were whispering a word, and I heard most of it, but not. Do you want to?
Yes, yeah, I have a few prophetic words, you mean, for that I have? I just wrote these down. There's just a couple of words that I have. And I know you said it in passing as a joke for your brother, but what's hilarious about the Holy Spirit is that there's times that we can say things in passing that we think are just like funny or just like little comments, and the Holy Spirit's like, no, I have something there. You're just picking up on it. And so the Lord gave me what I believe is a word for your brother, and so I'd like to pray for him, if that's okay. Yes? If you want to just stand up even where you're at, Or do you want him to come up here? What do you want?
Well, he doesn't want to be on camera.
Okay, that's fine. You can just stay there. But there's something that the Lord just kind of put on my heart. And one of the things that he spoke over you, I went over there to shake your hand, and the Lord just started speaking to me, too, at that time, too. And I felt like the Lord said that he had released an anointing of Nehemiah on you. And I saw that the Lord was saying, I saw a building, like a building project. And he said, the king has bankrolled you. And he said that I'm going to match your dreams with your budget, not the other way around.
Oh, come on.
And the Lord said this too. He said, you're actually going to help repair the wall. And I asked him, I said, what does that mean? He said, he's actually going to father other churches and help them get restored to where they're supposed to be. I saw you one that goes out and heals churches that are broken and damaged and falling apart. But just the Lord said, you will have many sons in life, in ministry. You'll have, I literally saw like satellites breaking off of you, like going out into other areas. I saw all these ropes that had, this might sound weird, but I saw all these ropes attached to other churches that you were with, that you were starting and helping and fathering. And it was a real apostolic mantle. And people get weirded out sometimes when you say apostle, but really what apostles are fathers. And they create, you know, they create children. And I just felt like the Lord said, you have a real father's heart to help broken people. And the Lord even spoke to my heart that you're going to help fallen ministers. I literally saw failed ministers. And the Lord said, I have a thing in you to help restore fallen ministers. And so I just want to pray for you for that, if that makes sense. And so, Lord, I just, Lord, we seal up these words that you've spoken. And Father, I thank you that he's one that will help failed ministers, God, that you're bankrolling his vision. Father God, that you're birthing even blueprints in his spirit, Father God. Radical ideas, God. And the Lord says, do not be fearful. The church will follow you. So, Lord, we just thank you that the community will follow him. God, I thank you for the many sons of the faith that he is raising up, God. And I thank you for the network, even, God, that he's going to launch.
Yeah.
God, the network of ministry.
Wow.
God, that he's going to launch and that he will be a covering. Yes, he will be a tent, God, that many will be able to gather under and find family and find solace and find healing. Lord, I thank you for the anointing on his life.
Thank you, Jesus.
In your name we pray. Amen. Well, yeah. Amen. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Yes, Lord. Wow. Were you at Starbucks with us yesterday? Because
no.
It's like you.
You know what's funny is sometimes when we prophesy, I say we because I'm just used to saying that. The Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit prophesies, our biggest issue is that sometimes things are so accurate that people are like, how can, like, you must have talked to somebody. And that's the spirit of doubt that we run into. And so I want to encourage us to raise the bar, raise the level of expectation, because God sees everything. I've literally prophesied over people, and they're so freaked out because they're like, seriously, we had that conversation verbatim in our car in the parking lot before we came into the church.
Yeah.
You know, and so the Lord sees everything.
Of course he does.
Right?
Amen.
Scott, I have a word for you too. Were you reading it off my iPad?
Nope.
when you were up here talking, you said something that just kind of like fired off the Lord's attention. You were saying like, you know, I'm still looking for where I fit, you know, and what I'm supposed to do and all that. And the Lord was like, hey, he's asking a question. And I was like, oh, okay. So I just started praying. And I don't know if this is going to make any sense to you, but I saw you sitting at a desk tinkering, right? And I saw you taking this object apart, wanting to know how it worked, right? And you're like opening it and studying it, trying to figure out how it's working. And I asked the Lord, I said, what is that? And he goes, those are businesses. And I felt like what the Lord was saying was he's going to open up a door for you for consulting business, literally helping people see, because you are an analytical man with an analytical mind, and you have a great mind, the Lord said. And he goes, and you're going to be able to step into businesses and help change their perspective on their business. And you're going to be able to take these things apart and help them run smoother. And I just literally saw the Lord called you, this is probably weird, but he called you a scientist of business. And he said, I've put a mold in your mind to think differently, and I'm actually going to use you for executives and private business owners that own their own companies to help them recalibrate their companies, recalibrate their business. But the Lord said, it's going to be a consulting thing, and it's going to bring finances into your house.
Thank
but the
you.
Lord says, you are a man of wisdom. But the Lord said, he goes, and I want you to embrace the fact that I've given you great wisdom and that other people need that wisdom. And not just ministry, like what you're talking about, you've got a great message in you for America and for the body of Christ, period.
Yes.
But I just saw the Lord saying that I also want to begin to breathe on your gift of wisdom as it relates to business. And the Lord says, I'm going to give you supernatural wisdom and revelation when you're meeting with business owners to help them come out of financial struggles and help them recalibrate their business to launch off into great things. And so, anyways, that's just what I felt. And I want to pray for you for that. Is that cool?
Oh, you bet.
All right, everybody, just extend your hands up here. So, Lord, I just thank you for Scott.
Yes,
Father, I thank you for his life. God, I thank you that you said he's a man whose motives you trust. Lord, and I just pray, God, right now for that that gift, God, of consulting and wisdom, recalibrating, God, understanding, Lord, that you would launch him, Father, full bore into that. God, I thank you that you are going to whisper his name in the wind, and you're going to be his PR man. Lord, I thank you, God. God, I thank you for his intellect. I pray you keep breathing on his mind. God, I pray even for his dream life, Lord, that it would come alive at a new level. Lord, I pray for witty inventions. Just like Proverbs 18 says, Lord, to have gifts of witty invention.
Mm, yes, Lord.
So, Lord, we just release witty inventions to him, Father. The spirit of creativity. Lord, for relationships to open, doors to open in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I have one last word, and that's for Bill. Bill, I shook your hand. You know, we met. And the Holy Spirit started speaking to me about your anointing. And this is what the Lord said. He said, you've got an Elisha anointing on your life. Now, Elisha had a double portion of Elijah's anointing. And I feel like the Lord says, I put this mantle on you. And the Lord, and I asked the Lord, I said, well, what does that mean? He's got an Elisha anointing. He said, he's got a double portion of anointing of the spiritual fathers that have spoken into his life. And the Lord even says this, I'm calling you to raise up Gehazis. But the Lord said, he goes, you're going to raise up Gehazis, and they will not be like the Gehazi of the Bible. Their eyes will be opened, and they will choose the right things. But the Lord says, I'm literally going to surround you with a generation, with a younger generation, and you're going to train them to see in the Spirit. The Lord says, you're going to be a father of the prophetic. And the Lord said, and you will raise up many sons and daughters in the prophetic movement. And the Lord says, I've called you to be almost like, he called you Rabboni, a teacher of the prophetic. And I just feel this mantle on your life to raise up Gehazis. Now, what's amazing about Gehazi, the story of Gehazi is this. He traveled with Elisha, right? And Gehazi always had trouble with his vision. He couldn't see the angel armies of God encamped around the pagan army until Elisha prayed for him. And there's going to be literally a shift when you pray for the next generation, where you pray for people. There'll be a shift in the spirit, and they will see things that they've never seen before. And Gehazi always, he failed at the end of his life, essentially. He pursued greed instead of what God had called him to do.
That's right.
And this was this was Gehazi's portion, was this. So Elisha got a double portion of Elijah's anointing, right? Which means, had Gehazi walked according to God's plan in his life, he would have received four times the anointing of what Elijah had.
Oh, think about that.
Now, Gehazi, his gift was speaking into realms of government, which means the Lord's going to use you to raise up a generation that's going to speak into realms of government, that they're literally going to speak into laws that will change. They're going to speak into realms of government that will change culture. But the Lord also said, I'm sending you there first, because you can't take anybody any place where you haven't been. And I just feel like the Lord said, I'm going to begin to open political doors for you to speak into the lives of political figures. And that literally people are going to seek you out for the word of the Lord. And that you will pray over this Gehazi generation, that they will fulfill their destiny. That you will raise them up. They will literally be bones that will be joined sinew to sinew, flesh to flesh, and they'll become the army. But the Lord says, I'm going to use you to speak into their life. I just want to pray for you. Does that make sense? All right, just extend your hands towards Bill. Lord, we just thank you for Bill. Holy Spirit, we just release God. Lord, we're not putting anything on him. We're calling something out of him. So, Lord, we just call forth in the name of Jesus, God, this Elisha anointing on his life, this double portion anointing. God, I thank you that you called Bill a son born of fire. Father God, that he's passed through the fire and he's come through his pure gold. Not just that, Bill, but the Lord also says this, I've made you a lighthouse for prodigals. The Lord says this, Bill, somebody has to put a ring on the prodigal's finger.
Jesus.
And he said, and it's going to be you. Somebody has to kill the fatted calf for the prodigal. And he said, and I'm blessing you so that you can do it. The Lord says, you will be a lighthouse that shows prodigals that it is safe to draw back to the Lord. Lord, I thank you that there's even a favor on his life to minister to prodigals. God, I thank you for the company of prodigals that he will raise up that will actually become prophets. The Lord says you will see the sons of Baal become the sons of Samuel. So, Lord, we just thank you, Father God, for the transition that's even going to come in people's lives from knowing Bill. God, I thank you for your promotion on his life. And we pray that you would anoint him and bless him in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Woo. Amen. Woo.
Kevin, this show is exactly, listen, this is exactly what you need.
Yeah.
This show. The Lord says this. You're Nathaniel.
Thank you, Lord.
He said everything you've experienced up to this point and what he's done with you in your career has been under a fig tree. Mm. And he says, but now I'm calling you out from under the fig tree, and that's what this is. And he goes, Kevin, you haven't seen anything yet.
Thank you.
He said, you thought you saw the miraculous where you were. Mm-hmm. He said, you haven't seen anything yet. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
He said, the places I'm taking you, he said, I'm going to promote you in ways that you only dreamed. But the Lord says this, they weren't dreams. They were God's destiny sown into your life.
Thank you, Lord.
The Lord says this, you can never repent for your calling of greatness. Mm. You have to embrace it. But the Lord says, this program is exactly what I have for you. Praise and he said, this is the ground level. I'm telling you, if you're online watching or if you're here, you need to get on board with what Kevin's mm-hmm. doing with this program because it is the heart of the Father. And it's going to open up guests and wisdom to this region.
Hallelujah.
It's going to help blow open the doors, not just in Branson mm-hmm. and in this region, but whoever can watch will receive an anointing.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Amen. Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Come on, let's bless the Lord. We keep to an hour usually just to practice for when we're doing TV, because we're going to be doing TV. So, I mean, we're not on yet, so we can go as long as we want. But I want to encourage people, this is just an appetizer. If you want to see all of you Branson people watching anywhere near in the state of Missouri, I'd get to the service tonight. He's going to be at Grace Community Assembly at 7 p.m. tonight, and he will minister, for as long as God leads him. And I like that you're so real and go with the Spirit of God. It's tonight. It's also tomorrow morning on Saturday morning at 10 a.m. It's also Sunday in both services they have there, and Sunday night. Is that correct?
At 6, yeah.
At 6 o'clock. So,
called Supernatural Branson, and it's a prophetic school. We're teaching people how to hear the voice of the Father for themselves and to step into their God-given destiny to prophesy.
And normally there's a charge for going to these conferences.
This is totally free. The church has said, look, we want to – I'm telling you, there's some places – I'm doing this in Rancho Cucamonga, California, where they're charging $350 a couple.
Right.
I mean, and we have such a good relationship with the Betzers at Grace Community that we've agreed to just do it for free for Branson, to say, come on out. Also, I spoke with your producer, and we're going to do something special for the Kevin Shorey Show.
Yeah?
Yep. We have, my ministry is called Prophetic Sheep, and it's based off of John 10:4, his sheep know his voice. And we have a 5-hour DVD, all classroom training on prophetic ministry. And what we're doing for the people that are here and the people watching online, if you contact the show through social media or you want it here, the website, kevinshorey.com, this is an exclusive offer just for your show, okay? Whoa. No other show is going to get this. We're working, when the book comes out, we'll be on Sid Roth. We're not doing any of that on Sid Roth. This is just for your show.
Whoa.
We are offering this 5-hour DVD for free.
Whoa.
And so what we're going to do is we're going to give it to the Kevin Shorey Show.
Thank you.
And you guys are going to make MP3s or CDs or however you want to do it.
Okay.
And you're just going to, anybody that wants it can have it.
Wow.
And these are typically $50 for the CD. And so you guys are all going to get these for free. You have to contact the show. They'll get you the MP3s or the CDs. We just want to bless you guys. We care more about you hearing than about the money. And praise so we just want to bless you. And we don't own it anyways, right? Jesus owns all these ideas. So, I mean, it's his.
That is awesome. That's the first I've heard of that, and I love it. Thank you, my brother.
You are so welcome.
You are so welcome to be here all the time. Matter of fact, if you could stay over from Monday. We had talked about it originally, and if it's still possible, I would love to put you back on Tuesday when we come back again, but we'll talk about that.
We'll
I don't
want
to put you on the spot. We'll chat if it's possible. I'll do whatever it takes. How would like to hear some more from Dr. Luke Holter? Amen. And And thank you, Scott, for being here. Thank you, Jeff, for ministering and just being obedient to the Lord. Do we have that new theme song to go out with today? We can just pretend we're actually ending now. And we'll be back next week with very many special guests, singers, and some pastors are all the way from Belfast, Northern Ireland. They'll be here next week. A great lineup, as usual. God has just really given us great lineup and great guests. And maybe I can twist his arm and just talk to his wife and see if he'll stay one more day before going. I don't know. But we will be back next week. Remember, until then, Jesus is still the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. How many know Jesus is the way? Come on, we'll see you.